Today I want to talk about Satan's emergent church movement. Now, many people are aware of this modern movement. I really even hate to call the thing a church, but you know, they claim to be Christian or post-Christian, or I mean, really what they claim is always constantly changing. But basically, it's a group of people that are trying to redo Christianity. They're lost. I don't believe any of them are saved, and you're going to see why I say that in this study. They are not just a little bit wrong. They are very, very heretical, blasphemous, just incredible. And they try to claim that they are true Christianity or something, I guess. But I want to show you that their main attack is on the written word of God. Right here, King James Bible. And you're going to see that that's actually true. But first, I want to start out here in 1 John chapter 5, verse 10 through 13. I am a Bible-believing Christian, by the way. Let me define that. I don't define Christianity based on my feelings or my emotions or on what's popular or whatever. My beliefs are based on a book. This book right here for the English-speaking Christian is the King James Bible. Okay, that's my final authority right there, not my feelings. Okay, let's start out here. 1 John chapter 5, verses 10 through 13. Let me read this. It says here, "He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son." Let me stop there for just a minute. The witness in himself is the Holy Ghost. But it's not just enough to have the Holy Ghost there. There's a record that's there, that's spoken of. But what is the record? Continue on here, verse 11. "And this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God." So you see, we are not left without a written record. Right here, the King James Bible is God's revealed, supernaturally inspired, Holy Spirit inspired set of written scriptures. That's why there's so many attacks on this book. This book is 400 years old this year, and yet it's the most attacked book. Been around for 400 years, but people attack it and they hate it. Kind of interesting. They wouldn't be doing that if this wasn't God's word. And it wouldn't have survived for 400 years either, by the way. A lot of these new versions, they don't make it 20 years. They don't make it 30 years. The ones that do, like the NIV and other perversions like that, they make it because they are actually published by secular publishers. Information on that out there, you can look that up. But and they're constantly having to revise it to keep it selling as good as a King James Bible too, by the way. It's because the Holy Spirit's not in it. Just plain and simple. Now, as I said earlier, salvation is not based on feelings, but rather on the revealed written word of God. Okay, given by inspiration of God's Holy Spirit. The lost world has always hated God's written word because it condemns them by exposing their sins. Yeah, absolutely. The rejection of absolute truth in a written form is a very old movement. You say, well, how old? Oh, a couple thousand years. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1 says, "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made, and he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said?" He questioned God's word, God's commandments to them. "Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden. And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die." Now God never said, neither shall ye touch it. Eve added to God's word. Okay? Very interesting. Genesis 3, 4. "And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die." Ooh. You see, Satan got Eve to doubt the word of God. And as soon as she started doubting it, Satan came along and he said, don't worry about it. That's not true. Now, it didn't exist in a written form at that point in time. It was later revealed to Moses, I believe, the first five books of your Old Testament, the Pentateuch, is what it's called. But that system there that Satan brought in of questioning, first he causes doubt, and then after you doubt the word of God, then he comes in and he says, it's actually not true. And once Satan has you to that point, look what he does next. Genesis 3:5. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Okay, now this tactic of Satan has been used. He's used this thing for thousands of years. And it works like this. It's a three-step plan. First of all, you question God's word and put a seed of doubt into the mind of the person that is being deceived. You know, the victim, so to speak. After you question God's word, after you start putting doubts in their mind, and they start to kind of think, maybe this Bible isn't true after all, then you have them. And then second, what you do is, you say, it's a good book, but it's not perfect. And after you cause the doubt, then you remove the Bible, and when the Bible's out of the picture, guess what? Next, you deify man and tell them that their feelings are the standard of truth. That is Satan's 6,000-year-old plan that he has used, and it's worked time and time and time again. And that's what Satan did in the Garden of Eden, and that's what Satan has done with this emergent church movement. Get rid of the book as final authority, and once that's done, then you come in and you deify them. You make them think that they are gods, that they are able to discern right and wrong based on what they feel. I'm not making this stuff up. I'm not exaggerating the point. You're going to see this thing, and I'm going to tell you, I'm going to warn you, if you don't know about this emergent church movement, it's going to be very vexing for you. It was incredibly vexing for me to put together this study. It took me about 2 days. There's a lot of scripture here, over 30 pages of notes. Okay, I didn't go to some website and get this thing. You know, I got the pictures, you know, their advertisements that this wicked satanic emergent church puts out. Got the pictures from online, but all the scripture and everything, you know, I had to put the thing together, and it was quite vexing. Okay, it's just disgusting what these people believe. But I'm going to show it to you in this study. Okay, and you're going to see this emergent church following Satan's three-step plan. And you say, well, yeah, but you know, I'm not emergent, you know, I'm not really into that, I won't fall for it. Yeah, but there's a problem. You see, the emergent church movement is also seeping into the modern church movement. The churches that weren't around 30 or 40 years ago, in other words, you know, that most of them are today, with the rock music and the no dress standards and any Bible will do, come as you are, you know, do as you please. That whole movement, the emergent church, is leading the way. And their philosophies are starting to seep into what would be called mainstream Christianity. I'm going to prove it to you in this study. Now let's start. First of all, the first plank of Satan's plan is to question God's word and cause doubt. Okay? That's what the new versions are about, by the way. That's what all these attacks on the King James Bible have always been. It's the first plank of Satan's plan. I mean, let me just say this kind of as a little side note thing here. There are people that would have you reject the entire King James Bible, greatest book that's ever been written. And that's a scientific fact. I've said it many times. It is a scientific fact that this is the greatest book ever written. Over 6 billion in print. You know, there's no book in history that has remained popular for 400 years and has gone into over 6 billion copies in print. You know, and if you go back and if you can find an original 1611 when this thing first came out, an original edition of the 1611, that thing is worth Some of them are worth over $1 million. I've seen auctions for them like that. Now show me another book that can compare to that. Show me another book that's worth that kind of money. This is the greatest book that's ever been written. That is a matter of historical, documented fact. It cannot be refuted. Okay? It's like saying, you know, a brick wall is hard. That's indisputable. Okay? There's no such thing as a soft brick wall that's made with real bricks. Okay? I'm going to be getting back to the brick wall thing here in a minute. This is the greatest book ever. So they would, you know, this movement of these new versions, they'll come out with these little puny attacks. They'll say, it says brass and it says Easter and the word unicorns in it. And so you should just reject the whole Bible as a result. See the philosophy? It's stupid. But what the new version movement is about, and I'm not talking about people that innocently use new versions. I used to use one. You know, I used an NIV for 15 years. Okay? It wasn't on purpose. It wasn't that I hated the King James Bible. I just didn't know any better. And I'm not attacking you if you use a new version. Okay? If you use a new version and you're ignorant of the subject, okay, fine. You know, learn it. Convert to the King James Bible. The people that I attack, though, are the ones who know about the Bible version issue and who persist in lying about the King James Bible and trying to destroy people's faith. You're working for Satan if you're doing that. Okay? And again, another reason is because you offer no perfect replacement. These people that stand for the new versions, the Alexandrian school of thought, it's naturalistic textual criticism. In other words, this book is just like any other book. You can critique it. You can mess around with it, whatever. That's not the beliefs of a Christian. A Bible-believing Christian says this is God's book. This thing is supernatural in its origin. And you shouldn't mess with it. Okay? Sorry for a little rant there, but just wanted to get that thing covered here. Now, poster number one. These are advertisements, I guess, if you will, that this wicked satanic emergent movement brings out. And I'm going to be using some harsh language. I'm going to call them idiots and fools and whatever else. If you get offended at that, well, you know, just don't bother watching or listening, you know. That's as far as that's going to go. I'm not offended, you know, if you get mad at me and call me judgmental and ignorant fool and, you know, I've been called a lot of good names. Doesn't bother me. So, you know, whatever. But let's start out here, okay? Poster number one, deconstruction. There's your brick wall. What kind of freedom would it be if we couldn't make the Bible mean what we want it to mean? And people say, oh, come on, they're just having fun. They don't really believe that. It's just kind of said in jest. No. A Christian wouldn't say that kind of a thing. A Christian would never say something as vile as that. All right, continue on to the next wicked picture. Here you have Gumby and Pokey, and Gumby's chest there, his belly's all in knots, and it says, texts, wonderful, bendable, highly amusing toys. Do you realize that this book right here, this King James Bible, is the fruit of millions of martyrs being killed by the Catholic Church that tried to stop this book from coming out, and the Catholic Church that brings out the new versions to try and replace this book? Documented fact, okay? Look at your new version, and where they take verses out, it says, not in the two oldest and best manuscripts. Okay, and you look and you do the research, the oldest, their favorite one, you have Sinaiticus, Codex Aleph, yes, I understand that, but their big one is Codex B, the Vaticanus manuscript. Okay, and where is it held at? Surprise, surprise, it's in the Vatican. Okay, watch my other videos, I have this stuff documented. The Nestle's 27th edition is made partly by a Jesuit cardinal, Cardinal Carlo Maria Martini. Documented fact. The Nestle's 27th edition, right in the introduction, I have it documented in my other videos. It says in the introduction that this text is made under the supervision of the Vatican. And that's what the new versions are based on. Actually, they're based on older editions of the Nestle's text. another story. But the point is, that picture there, look at it again. If you read the verses there behind it, it's the King James Bible. Luke chapter 3, as a matter of fact. That is the text that they're making fun of. They're calling it an amusing toy. And you want me to believe that these people are Christians? I don't think so. Let's go on to the next one. The next picture of this guy in a prison there on the bars, and it says, hermeneutics, a thoroughly modern power tool used by fundamentalists to marginalize disenfranchised people groups and post-evangelicals. Yeah, oh, you know, you got me there, oh boy. Like, let me just say something. When you actually look into the thing of the fundamental, you know, you're a fundamentalist, it's such a watered down, you know, the deity of Christ, the virgin birth, and this. Well, who doesn't believe that? You know, it's not like I'm taking a strong stand, I'm a fundamentalist. I never really understood that. I mean, if you don't believe in the fundamentals of the faith, you're not saved. Don't give me this tough, oh, you know, I'm not a fundamentalist. Well, then you're lost and on your way to hell. Okay? It's the basics of Scripture. It's not some big hardcore stand that you have to take. I believe in the fundamentals of the faith. Well, so what? It's the clear teachings of Scripture. You know? But these wicked, lost people, they come along and they try to steal things from the Bible without believing in the miracles, without believing in the virgin birth of Jesus Christ and his sinless life and whatever else, you know, the fundamentals. And then they try to say, I'm a Christian, but I deny all that stuff from the Bible. No, I'm sorry. If you're not a fundamentalist, you're lost and on your way to hell. Okay? So ridiculous. But let's look about this thing of, you know, all this poor guy's in prison. You know, he's imprisoned by the fundamentals of the faith as found in the King James Bible. Let's look about that. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 says, but the natural man, the lost man, the man who has not been regenerated, that's the natural man, the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. You say, well, I'm spiritual. You see that thing, you know, I love that. This, I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual. Yeah. Okay, yeah, your spirit is a devil that's in you. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, you're lost. You have a devil, okay? Don't give me this, all you can spiritually discern it. No, you can't. That's why a lot of people can't understand this book, the King James Bible, because it's a spiritual book. And you have to have the Holy Spirit within you to understand it. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3 says, and you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. You were dead. Wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. There you have the spirit. You're a spiritual person, but you're not saved. Right there, the prince of the power of the air. Satan is your father. Satan is the spirit that tells you what to do. Verse 3, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. Oh, God loves the sinner. No, he doesn't. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, present tense, that God loves Christ-rejecting sinners. Doesn't say it. And I have a whole study on it. You can hear it for free. I go through all the scriptures that talk about God's love. God's love, present tense, is only for saved, born-again, Bible-believing Christians. God does not love lost Christ-rejecting sinners. They are children of wrath. Scripture after scripture after scripture proving that. You say, well, what about for God so loved the world? John 3:16, yeah. What about that? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That's past tense. God's love is manifest at Calvary. And if you reject his love there, you don't have God's love. God's love isn't for you. God's wrath is for you if you reject Jesus Christ. Deal with it. Now, you say, well, this poor guy, he's imprisoned by the Bible, you know, Bible preaching. Well, what about that? What if you're saved? Are you bound to Jesus Christ and the Bible? Yes, you are. You are bound to this book if you're saved. Okay? Your Heavenly Father wrote that as instructions for how you should live. Oh, what a terrible thing. No, it isn't. It's a good thing. Let me give you a couple scriptures here. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I want to be a bondservant of Jesus Christ. I want him telling me how to dress, what kind of music to listen to, what kind of things that I should watch with my eyes, what kind of things I should be doing with my time. I want him to do that. Okay? I'm not in prison. I'm not some kind of, oh, you know, I wish I could just do what I feel like doing. Whenever I do what I feel like doing, it leads me to sin. It leads me to suffering, to pain. There's no such thing as a good sin. And if you believe that there is, it's because you're lost and a child of wrath and stupid too. Deal with it. Next poster, narrative theology. Just like a chick track, only way cooler. Of course, these emergent devils, they wouldn't appreciate the chick tracks. And of course, they're showing there one of the Alberto ones talk about the Jesuits. And you know, I have it documented in my Real Bible Version Issue Exposed videos. How that one of these guys, Tony Jones, in his book on youth ministry, he's one of the big leaders in the emergent church movement. Well, he was until he had an affair, but you know, that's another thing. But in his book on youth ministry, he talks about Jesuit, you know, the spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius de Loyola. Jesuit mind control exercises, and we should employ these when we're working with the youth, you know. So, of course, they wouldn't appreciate a chick track that exposes the Jesuits. And you look time and time again at these emergent devils, these big leaders, Brian McLaren and Tickle, the Phyllis Tickle or whatever, that woman, whatever her name is. It's, well, we're pro-Catholic. Oh, we're all for Catholic. We need to destroy the Reformation, the ideals of the Reformation. Yep. How much you want to bet that they're probably all Jesuits? Being trained to raise up this wicked satanic filth. Next poster. Here we have one of the other guys. I don't remember this guy's name, but he's one of the leaders and the thing, and he's dressed like a country hillbilly, you know. He's making fun of country people. Like me, I guess. Wholeness. People read this stuff and think it has answers that can help their stress better than yoga? Get serious. You say, well, it's a joke, though. It's a joke. It's just meant to be funny. That's not funny. That's blasphemy. Comparing the Bible to yoga. This transcendental meditation, yoga, kundalini yoga, serpent coming up through your spine and ajna chakra and all that garbage. Possessing. It's basically you're opening yourself up to just be filled with devils is what you're doing. That's what yoga is. Yoga is a bunch of junk, new age garbage. It's disgusting. And that's better, you know. You know, people actually, you know, read the Bible and, oh, you know, yeah. These people aren't Christians. These people are wicked. And you're going to see what the purpose of their system, of their movement is as we continue. And by the way, they talk about love and tolerance and respect and everything. What about love and tolerance for simple country Bible-believing Christians? Obviously, they're making fun. You know, the guy's laying on a big bale of hay. You know, hay seed. You know, he's an old country hillbilly. These people, they love to make fun of us people that come from the country. I was raised in the woods. You know, farmland all around and everything. Raised here in Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. Amish country. You know, I grew up around farms. My ancestors were all farmers. You know, I don't like being in the cities. You know, I'm a country boy. I'm a hillbilly. Okay? And they'll make fun of us all the time. They make fun of us. Just, you're just one of them ignorant country people. Well, you know, compared to you, yeah, you know, I'd rather be from the country. Thank you very much. See, the point is, when these hypocrites preach tolerance and respect and, you know, diversity and all this stuff, they only mean it for themselves. People that oppose them and country people that have a simple faith, that haven't been into the cities and haven't been into the universities and things to have their minds messed up, you know, us people that have the simple faith, we're a threat to them. Okay? They don't like us very much. It's fine. I don't like you either if you're one of these people, one of these emergents. And if you are one of them, you know, open your mind up, you know, be tolerant, watch the thing, and realize that you're not a Christian. Realize that you're not saved because of the scriptures that I'm giving you here. Continuing on, 1 Corinthians 1:26. Let's look at what the Bible says about the, you know, hillbillies. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And base things of the world and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and the things and things which are not to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. And by the way, you know, don't get offended if I'm ripping on the city and things like that. I don't like the city, and you know, but I have brethren in the city that are the same as me, mentally speaking. You know, we have the same spirit in us. We're the common man that Jesus Christ preached to. We're not special. We're not highly educated or rich or famous or anything else. We're just common people. We're simple people. You know, and we get made fun of. Big deal. You know, you make fun of me, I'll make fun of you. Doesn't bother me a bit. But the whole thing is, if these people want to make fun of me because of my stance for the King James Bible, well, right there. God doesn't choose you if you're powerful or noble or rich or whatever else. God chooses the weak. God chooses the country hillbillies. God chooses the guy that lives in the bad section of town. All right, the simple guy that doesn't just believes the book without having to prove that he's smart enough to correct it. That's who God chooses. And I have some real good fellowship too, by the way, with city folk, you know, that are of the same mind. Continuing on here, stories, the next poster. Myths we entertain our minds with so we can avoid nasty modern categories like truth, reality, and divine revelation. These people are lunatics. I hate to be classified with truth or reality or divine revelation. Yeah. Okay. Romans chapter 3, verse 3 and 4 says, "For what if some did not believe? Shall their unbelief make the faith of God without effect? God forbid. Yea, let God be true, but every man a liar, as it is written, that thou mightest be justified in thy sayings and mightest overcome when thou art judged." Let God be true and every man a liar. These emergent people are liars. And I'll correct them with the Bible, the King James Bible. Next picture, sensitivity. The Bible intimidates people. Besides, my tats and t-shirt are clear enough. Amen. The Bible intimidates people. Amen. You want to see it proved? This is another thing that you can prove scientifically. See, science is testable, it's observable, it's demonstrable. And you can do this test on your own. You know, what you do is get a nice black King James Bible like this. If you really want to make it good, put the big sticker on the front like that so people can tell. Black King James Bible with the gold gilt edge, and then you put on a nice clothes like this and walk down the street where there's a lot of people. Just walk down the street. You don't even have to talk to anybody or hand out tracts or anything. That's good. But just walk down the street. And you'll see the Holy Spirit is in this book, because people will avoid you like you have some, like you're a two-headed monster. Yeah, this is offensive to the lost world. Of course it's offensive. Did you know that Jesus Christ offended people when he was here on this earth? Those people that followed him, you know what they were doing? Most of them were there to see him heal people or to be healed themselves. And when the Pharisees and the scribes and Sadducees, when they turned on Jesus, they turned those, his followers, most of those people, they turned them on Jesus just like that. One minute they're praising him, worshiping him, and the next minute they're screaming to crucify him. You know why? Because he offends people. The gospel of Jesus Christ is an offense. The Bible talks about the offense of the cross. There is an offense there. The Bible is supposed to offend the lost world. And you say, but my t-shirt and my tattoos, they're a good witness. We're going to talk about tattoos here in just a little bit. But continuing on here, you say, I'm kind of ashamed of this Bible. I'm going to put it back here behind my back and pretend I don't have one. What's the Bible say about that? What's the Lord Jesus Christ say about that? Mark chapter 8, verse 38 says, whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Luke chapter 9, verse 26, for whosoever shall be ashamed of me and of my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he shall come in his own glory and in his Father's and of the holy angels. The Bible is supposed to offend the lost. Okay? It's a holy book. And the children, the majority of the people out there, the Bible says about wide is the gate that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. The majority of people are on their way to hell. The majority of people are children of Satan. Of course the Bible is going to offend them. When you say, well, I'm kind of ashamed of that, then Jesus Christ is ashamed of you. Plain and simple. If you're bothered by the fact that you offend people as a Christian, you better check and see if you're really saved. Okay? You shouldn't go out of your way to offend people, but the point is, you just live as a Christian. You know, the Bible talks about separation. We're to come out from among them, be separate. Touch not the unclean thing. You know, the Bible talks about. The fact is, you really don't have to go out of your way to make yourself separate from people. You live as a Christian, you live by the words of the King James Bible, and people won't want to be around you. It's plain and simple. Psalm 138, verse 2. People say, oh, it's not a big deal. The Bible's not a big issue. You better check the scripture. I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth, for thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name. Let me tell you something. No true Christian would ever reject the Bible. No true Christian would ever say, I don't want anything to do with this book. This is an amusing toy. I'm ashamed of it. If that's what you believe, you're not saved. I didn't say somebody that uses a new version isn't saved. I didn't say that. I didn't say if you've backed off and denied the Lord a time or two, as far as in the sense of you were embarrassed to talk about him or something like that. I'm not talking about denying him salvation-wise. But I'm talking about if occasionally you've kept your mouth shut when you shouldn't have, if you should have spoken up and you didn't, you need to get that thing fixed up. I've done it a couple times in my life. I've been stupid. There have been times that I've had opportunities to witness and I didn't take it. Well, I'm going to have to answer for that one day. But I'm doing my very best to not do that again in the future. That's the way it's supposed to be. Okay? Don't be ashamed of, don't be ashamed of Jesus. Don't be ashamed of his book. All right? He wasn't ashamed of you when he died on the cross and paid for your sins. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. Now, that's the first thing. First thing is you cast doubt into people's mind. You start to say a better translation would be things like that. You know, the Greek, it's not accurate to the Greek or the Hebrew or the blah, blah, blah. You put doubts into their mind. And then after they have doubts in their mind, then you come in and you say, this book isn't really God's word. It's just a translation. It's a good book. It's a good book, but it's not really God's inspired, Holy Spirit inspired scriptures that can lead you into all truth. No, you know, it's just a book, right? And here's what they do. First of all, they attack the Word of God. Now look what they do next. Remove God's Word as the authority. Now that they've gotten you to doubt it, now they remove it. Here you have this loser, and it says maturity. Yeah, when I was like you, I never doubted the Bible either, but I outgrew that. And this is a sign of spiritual maturity, I imagine. Well, if you're a wicked, you know, possessed with devils loser like that guy, then yeah, I guess it would be going the right direction for you. I mean, if you want to go to hell, you want to be a child of disobedience, a child of wrath, then yeah, that's the direction that you want to go. If you want to go to heaven, you exalt the Word of God. If you want to go to hell and burn forever with this loser, then, you know, yeah, get rid of the Word of God. Say that you outgrew belief in it. You know? Ridiculous. Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5 says, every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in Him. Add thou not unto His words, lest He reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. That's what these people are. They're adding things to God's Word. This isn't enough. We have to add all these new things. And you're going to see some of the stuff that they add as we continue. Let's go to the next picture. Doctrine. Who's afraid of the slippery slope? Well, you better be if you're a Christian. When people start to deny doctrine and attack doctrine, it is a slippery slope. And we're seeing, by the way, the great falling away that the Bible talks about. We're going to see those scriptures here as we continue. But the fact is, there is a falling away. Let's look at some scriptures here. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 4 says, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at His appearing and His kingdom, preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables. It's exactly what this emergent church is. They turn away their ears from the truth, as revealed in Scripture, and they listen to fables. They go back to Eastern mysticism, and they go to the Catholic Church and Jesuitical type of things. That's what they do. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 10 through 12. You say, well, it's, you know, no big deal if we reject truth. Really? Let's look at that. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. You know what these emergent devils, these people in this movement, you know what they're headed for? And if you're one of them, you know what you're headed for? You're headed for God's wrath and damnation to hell forever. Why? Because you receive not the love of the truth. You reject the Bible as the final authority. And you say, truth is relative. What is truth? Who can really say what is truth? You're deceived. And guess what? God's going to oblige you. You reject absolute truth. You don't want absolute truth. God's going to send you delusion. God's going to send you deceit. You say, why? I don't understand. God can't do evil. No, God Himself doesn't do evil. But what He does is He says, if you want this deception, I'll protect you from it. If you get saved, I'll lead you into the truth. But if you want the deception, if you reject Jesus Christ, if you reject the Word of God, then I'm going to give you exactly what you want. So in that sense, yes, God does create evil. He says to Satan, hey, you there, go deceive that person. Why? Because that's what they're asking for. They don't want Jesus Christ. They don't want the Word of God. They don't want to be transformed by the Word of God, by the renewing of their minds. They want to be conformed to the world. And that's exactly what these people do. They don't want to give up sin. They don't want to give up the fashions and the styles of the lost world. the heathen world. We'll see that as we continue here. Next poster. Imagination. It's where leprechauns and unicorns come from. Why not doctrine too? Imagination? No, stupid. Doctrine comes from the Bible. That's where it comes from. And of course, you have the unicorn there, a little jab at the King James Bible. Next poster. Paradox. Truth, in quotations, truth or nonsense. What's the difference anyway? Truth or nonsense? You know, what's truth? See? See the satanic? I mean, it's just weird. It's mental illness to say, I don't believe in absolute truth. You're mentally ill. Okay? You don't believe in absolute truth. You need to be locked up. Okay? I wouldn't put you in a camp and torture you or anything. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a funny farm. Okay? You need to be put in a padded room in a straitjacket if you don't believe in absolute truth. I mean, truly don't believe in absolute truth. I mean, most of these people, it's just that they're wicked sinners and don't want anybody telling them what to do, as we're going to see as we continue. And that's why they're saying, oh, I don't believe in truth. You know, real people that don't believe in absolute truth, they need to be locked up. They're a danger to other people. Okay, they're cuckoo. John chapter 14, verse 6. You know, is truth nonsense? Let's look at this. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Jesus Christ is the truth, the manifestation of the truth. John 17, 17 says, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. So you have Jesus Christ is the truth, and his word, his written word, the written record of God's Son, King James Bible, for the English-speaking people, this book right here is something that you have to accept. You want to accept Jesus Christ, you got to accept his book, too. That's the way it is. Now I'm going to show you here that these pathetic sinners are openly rejecting Jesus Christ. Let's look at the next poster. Truth. It's an adventure, not an axiom. A story still unfolding, not a tale already told. The journey is what counts, not the destination, right? Not a tale already told. Jesus Christ, the written record. Anybody rejects this written record, they're rejecting Jesus Christ. So it's not in there. It's not in there. It's something you have to feel. No, it's been written down, and this is the record that you must believe if you want to be saved. It's the way it is. And you say, what's the word axiom mean? Well, it means an absolute, unquestionable fact. Isn't that what Jesus Christ said in John 14, 6? I am the way, the truth, the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Jesus Christ is an axiom. He's the only one that provides salvation. It's the way it is. So they're denying Jesus Christ. And again, you know, people would say, well, they're just putting the poster out, you know, to elicit conversation. You wouldn't write that stuff if you were a Christian. A Christian does not say vile, blasphemous things and then say, oh, I was just trying to start a conversation. Uh-uh. No, I don't think so. Revelation 22, verse 18 and 19 says, for I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. Adding to scripture is a sin that will land you in hell. Yeah, it is. And they say, well, the destination isn't important in that poster that I showed you there. Destination is not important. Yes, it is. It's very important. Revelation chapter 20, verse 15 says, and whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Now, if you remember there in verse 20 or chapter 22, verse 19, it says, if you take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life. Down there it says, whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Revelation 20, verse 15. You better not mess with this book. Okay? And let me tell you this. Your final destination, whether you go to heaven or hell, that's the single most important question that you will ever face in this life. There is nothing more important than your eternity. And whatever you have to give up down here to follow Jesus Christ, it's worth it. There's no sin on this planet, not one, that should keep you from getting saved. And yet the majority do, all the time. Sin keeps them from Jesus Christ. All right, here the next one. Faith, doubt, question everything. Romans chapter 14, verse 23 says, and he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of faith, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin. The Bible says the just shall live by faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. And they're saying, question everything. See? See the satanic philosophy there? Bad. And you say, well, what about the question everything? Well, yeah, what about that? What was the very first time, or what was the very first question in the Bible? Well, we read it earlier, if you remember. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1 says, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? There's your first question. So who is it that comes up with questions and gets people to deny absolute truth? It's Satan. That's why I say these emergent people are Satanists. True ones, okay? That bunch of baloney out there, Anton LaVey and Church of Satan and Temple of Set and all this other stuff, those are just fleshly, you know, fornicating drug addicts. That's what those people are. Witchcraft, they're just fleshly fornicating, trying to get in touch with devils to perform spells and whatever. True Satanism, according to 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 13 through 15, is ministers of righteousness. It's churches. It's religion. And look at Satan himself. Isaiah chapter 14, he wanted to be like the Most High. He's trying constantly to become God. All right? Satan is in the churches. He's not in some dingy warehouse somewhere with, you know, dressed in black with human sacrifice and drugs and, you know, people fornicating. That's not where Satan's at. I'm not saying that those people aren't, you know, being used by Satan. They are. But he gets most of his work done in churches. Be very careful where you go to church. Continuing. Next poster. Openness. Nope. No clue where we are headed. Why does that matter? Are you kidding me? No, they're not kidding. 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 12 through 14. But these, as natural brute beasts, made to be taken and destroyed, speak evil of the things that they understand not. If you're too stupid to understand this King James Bible because you're lost and because you're wicked and you hate it, then don't talk about it like you know what you're talking about. Don't act like, oh, you know, I don't know where I'm going and what's that matter. Just keep your mouth shut, okay? And shall utterly perish in their own corruption. Verse 13, and shall receive the reward of unrighteousness as they that count it pleasure to riot in the daytime. Spots they are and blemishes, sporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you. Having eyes full of adultery and that cannot cease from sin, beguiling unstable souls and hurt and heart they have exercised with covetous practices, cursed children. And that's exactly what these emergent people are. They are cursed children and they do beguile unstable souls. They'll go get some guy that's been on drugs and whatever else and he's trying to find the Lord and they, you know, he doesn't really know and is there really a God and whatever else. And these wicked devils will come to him and they'll say, you don't need the Bible. Man, here, you know, you're cool. We're cool with what you're doing, dude. You know, you don't have to repent. You don't have to do anything. just kind of hang out, and we'll tell you about how much Jesus loves you and stuff, and how Jesus is cool. You know what you are? You're the enemy. You're a cursed children, according to that scripture right there. Ephesians 4:14 says that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Again, that's what these people are doing. They lie in wait to deceive. All right? Disgusting. James 1:6 through 8 says, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven from the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Now, it's specifically talking about a believer, but even more so is it true about these types of people that deny absolute truth. You're not going to receive anything from the Lord. Are you kidding me? You reject His Word, you reject Jesus Christ, you reject absolute truth. Jesus is absolute truth. You reject Him. He's going to bless me. No, He won't. No, He isn't. And it's interesting because these nuts, these New Age emergent nuts, they'll try anything but the Bible. They'll get into mysticism and they'll do all kinds of Far East things and walk in labyrinths and stuff like that, burning incense and whatever other nonsense. But they won't try Jesus Christ. They won't try to live as a Christian. Continuing. Now the Bible has been, you've cast doubt on the Bible, and now you've removed it from the people, and now you deify man and make their feelings the standard for truth. Here you have belief. It can't be true if I don't like it. Substitutionary atonement and the exclusivity of Christ. And they're not quoting the King James Bible there anymore, which whatever. But substitutionary atonement and the exclusivity of Christ. It can't be true if I don't like it. But you know what you can do? You can go to hell. You reject the atonement of Jesus Christ. You reject the exclusivity of Christ, that there's other ways to heaven. You can go to hell, because that's where you're going. Sorry, Jesus Christ is the only way into heaven. That's it. You reject Him, you go to hell. I'm not cussing, I'm telling you the truth. Next one, evangelism. We don't bring God to the other, but find God in the other. Oh boy. Every Satanist, that's their core philosophy. Ye can be as gods. Every satanic philosophy out there, whether it's Catholicism teaches that the priest is another Christ, the Pope is vicarius filii Dei, faithful substitute son of God, or even some might say God, the Pope is God's man on earth, and you look at the Catechism, again, this is in other studies, the Catechism teaches that man can become God. So Catholicism teaches it. A lot of the other Far Eastern things, if you attain to such levels of mental power and spiritual enlightenment, you become a God. Why? Because they're satanic. And that's exactly what these people are. They're teaching the same thing. You don't bring God to people, you find God in people. No, you don't. Okay? You bring the Lord Jesus Christ to people and say, hey, your self-righteousness is going to land you in hell. Your only hope is the shed blood of Jesus Christ that He shed on the cross. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. That's all there is to it. Sorry, your self-righteousness doesn't come into it. Okay, next one. Here you have a guy that's, a real fine Christian, I'm sure. Incarnational living. What would Jesus do? I'm pretty sure He'd do the kind of stuff I think is cool. And the guy's all molested and everything, tattooed and pierced and, heathen. And, Jesus would be into the kind of things I'd think, is good. Why is He saying that? because in his warped little mind, he thinks he's God. Yeah. Continuing, holiness. Of course we take it seriously. Why do you ask? They put the little joke, you know, glasses in the nose and stuff there. That's a funny thing, you know. It's a funny thing to make fun of God's holiness. Real funny. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13 through 16 says, wherefore gird up the loins of your mind to be sober and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. God's holiness is not something that you make fun of. God's holiness is not a joke. And if you're a Christian, if you're truly saved, you will be holy. And the world, oh, they're holier than thou. Yes, absolutely, totally, 100%, yes. That's the way I'm supposed to be. I'm supposed to be holier than the lost world, than children of wrath, children of disobedience. I'm supposed to be an obedient child to my Heavenly Father. I'm supposed to not bring reproach to His name. That's the way you're supposed to be as a Christian. And the world doesn't like that. That's the way it's supposed to be. But look at the next vile, blasphemous poster that these devils put out. Atonement. All we have are theories anyway, so why not make a toy out of it? You put the cross of Jesus Christ, where he bled and died and suffered for my sins and for the sins of the other Christians out there. And you put Legos on it and you make it a toy. You make fun of it. You call the Word of God God's holy, inspired Word, the book which millions of Christians had to die so that we could have it in our hands. And you take this book and you call it a toy, and then you take the cross of Jesus Christ and you make it into a toy. Let me tell you something. If you're part of the emergent church and you don't repent, you don't get out of that thing, you're going to go to hell and you're going to burn and you're going to burn and you're not going to burn up. You're going to burn forever. And your wicked, satanic, filled with devil leaders are telling you that hell doesn't exist. They're lying to you. Hell does exist. Jesus Christ preached about it. And I preach about it because I love the lost world. I have enough love that I tell them the truth. Just disgusting. But continuing on with the vile blasphemy, I apologize to my saved brethren out there. I'm just showing what's going on here. A lot of this stuff, people wouldn't believe me if I didn't show it. You know, there's a line to draw, I realize that, but I'm showing you what this emergent movement is all about and how this philosophy is pushing the envelope that the modern church is using to justify their sins. More on that later. Here you have a picture of this guy that's supposed to be Jesus, I guess, there, and it says, what would Jesus drink? And then you have Beersheba, you know, and it's talking about art. You know, a lot of this modern art, it's just a bunch of wicked perverts that don't actually have any talent at all. You know, like the guy that was throwing excrement onto a picture of Mary or something like that. You know, cutting a goat in half or something, putting it in a vat of urine. You know, they say, oh, that's art. No, it's a wicked, satanic pervert that needs to be put in a mental institution. That's not art. Okay? My grandfather was an artist. I worked as an artist for a while. All right, I've seen art. It's technically difficult. Okay? A real, true artist is somebody who has talent. Somebody that can paint a very fine, intricate painting and make it look very lifelike. That's art. Not some weird, drugged up loser that takes a piece of white paper and throws paint at it or something like that. That's not art. Okay? It might be classified by the demented pagans out there that, oh, this is something new, we haven't seen this before. That's not true art, though. True art is a talent that somebody doesn't, the average person does not have. Next poster. Relevance. Tell me what I want to hear or else shut up and go away. See, you really shouldn't. If you're part of this movement, you shouldn't be offended by my crude speech, me calling you idiots and losers and stuff like that, because your own, you know, papers are saying the same things, using the same language. You shouldn't be offended. Of course, you will be if you're part of the movement. It's interesting because the Bible talked about they shall turn away their ears from the truth, you know, and they receive not the love of the truth. This guy, long-haired sissy, you know, he wants to be told the truth or else just shut up and go away. Yeah. Here we have another one. Justification. Thank you that I'm not like those smug Pharisees. Well, actually, let's see about the definition, the biblical definition of a Pharisee. And we're going to see that actually, yes, they are the Pharisees. Let's look here. Matthew chapter 15, verse 1. Then came to Jesus scribes and Pharisees, which were of Jerusalem, saying, Why do thy disciples transgress the tradition of the elders, for they wash not their hands when they eat bread? But he answered and said unto them, Why do ye also transgress the commandment of God by your tradition? For God commanded, saying, Honor thy father and mother, and he that curseth father or mother, let him die the death. But ye say, Whosoever shall say to his father or his mother, It is a gift, by whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, and honor not his father or his mother, he shall be free. Thus have ye made the commandment of God of none effect by your tradition. Ye hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, This people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth, and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. But in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. You see, what the wicked apostate, you know, professing church out there, who they try to classify as a Pharisee, are Bible believers, like me. They say, oh, you're legalistic. You're a Pharisee. Why? Well, because you hold to the Bible. You're always holding the Bible up, putting it in people's faces. You're a Bible thumper. No, actually, a Bible thumper, a Bible believer, is not a Pharisee, according to the standard Jesus Christ just laid out there in Matthew chapter 15. You see, a Pharisee is somebody that takes tradition, something that they've created, and they hold it above the Bible. They get rid of this book. Remember, like we talked about earlier? Okay, a real true Pharisee is somebody that has different standards of righteousness than the standards in Scripture. Okay, I'm not the Pharisee. These emergent people that hold their own beliefs and their own feelings and their own traditions above the Word of God, they're the Pharisees. You're the Pharisee. But what do they say about tradition? You say, oh, you know, I don't know about this stuff. What about tradition? What do they say? Here's another poster. Tradition, we invent our own as we go. Exactly what I just told you. They are the Pharisees. If you're an emergent movement, whatever, you're a Pharisee. Why? Because your traditions are created as you go. And your traditions are all to overthrow this book, the standards in this book. All right, continuing on. And here's where it starts to get a little bit more dangerous now. These people, these emergent people, are not like the carnal Laodicean modern church professing Christians, okay? They're actually borrowing things from the occult and from false religions. Let me show you. Here, isn't this a wonderful thing to do as a Christian here? It says, attitude, the saucier the better, unless you are a doctrine cop. Nice thought there. In that case, you're just arrogant and pharisaical. So because I don't destroy my body that belongs to God, because I don't defile my flesh, putting piercings and things all through me, because, you know, I'm a doctrine cop. Well, you want to make me a doctrine cop? Well, then amen. You're under arrest. Devotion. Because the greatest love of all is easy to achieve. And I think that's a girl sitting there. I love myself, you know. Yeah, you know, and maybe you ought to carry a little card, walk around that says, I'm mentally stable. You know, put a little button on you, so I love myself. Why? You know, whatever. But the greatest love of all is loving yourself. Oh, really? Let's see what Jesus Christ had to say about that. John chapter 15, verse 13 says, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." What the Lord Jesus Christ did on the cross is the greatest love that there's ever been. Why? Because he did something for us as Christians that we didn't deserve. You know, hey, lay down your life for a good man. You know, you hear that all the time in war. You know, you get these soldiers and they die a heroic death. You know, a grenade drops down into the foxhole where they're at, and one of the soldiers jumps on the grenade, takes it in his guts, and boom, you know, kills him so he can save his buddies. Well, he was doing that for men that he loved, for men that he cared about. Those guys were good guys. A lot of times those soldiers are good men. You know, not saying morally, you know, sometimes soldiers are wicked, but the point is they're fighting and whatever else, and a soldier will lay down his life for his brothers in arms. And that's good, that's honorable. It's a wonderful thing. But Jesus Christ laid down his life for wicked sinners. That's something else. There's no greater love than that. None. Don't even tell me about it. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 says, "This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come." Are we living in perilous times? Yeah. "For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers," like the emergent people, "disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy," as we saw they admit to earlier. Verse 3, "without natural affection." A lot of these people are sodomites and think sodomy's okay. "Truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce." We're going to see that as we continue. "Despisers of those that are good." Hello. You know, they don't like people like me. Verse 4. "Traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away." Say, "Well, Brian, why don't you go out and hang out with the emergent people and talk to them and just, you know, kind of see what they're all about?" Uh-uh. No way. Nope. Biblical separation. "From such turn away." I'll have nothing to do with them. This is as close as I want to get to even having anything to do with these people, these wicked people, touching their filthy, you know, posters that they put out and exposing them for the Satanists that they are. It's disgusting. Lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Remember that? Look at the next poster. Apologetics. Orthodox, heretical, who cares? Let's find some common ground. Why couldn't you make common ground meeting in a park someplace? Why couldn't you make common ground drinking a cup of tea or coffee or something like that? Why does it have to be beer? You associate with one of the most wicked forms of my grandfather used to call it devil pee, is what he called it. Get offended, I don't care. Why? Because that thing right there, alcohol, beer, has destroyed more homes, more little kids molested by their parents, beat up by their drunkard father or drunkard mother, families torn apart, ripped apart, drunk driving accidents. And that's the common ground that you find with a lost person. No, it's actually two lost people finding common ground. You say, "Well, come on now, you're overreacting." Really? Look at the next picture. Heaven. "Forget pie in the sky and the sweet by and by. We want us some kingdom come for the hectic here and now." Heaven is a bar with taps of different types of beer. Well, that would be heaven for somebody who's on their way to hell. Somebody who's lost. You say, "Oh, you don't drink beer, Brian?" No, I don't. I won't go near a bar. I won't go near an alcohol store. I don't want anything to do with alcohol. I've seen what it does to people. You kidding me? I don't even associate with the garbage. "Well, Jesus drank wine, you know, yeah, whatever." You people, it's just so disgusting to me. trying to justify your sin. And by the way, if you're a part of the emergent movement, I would suggest you drink as much as, and you don't want to repent, you don't want to get saved, you know, you don't want to come to Jesus Christ, you don't want to believe the book, then I would suggest you do as much partying and drinking and fornicating and whatever else you weird people do. Do as much of it as you can, because you've got all of hell to look forward to for all of eternity. The next section here, the extreme danger of the emergent movement. I want to talk about that here next. These losers are militantly against Bible-believing Christians right now, and I believe that eventually they're going to be the ones that are used by the Antichrist to bring persecution on true believers. Look here. Ecclesiology, willingness to challenge traditional expressions of church. I have no problem with that. You know, I don't have a problem challenging traditional expressions. You know, I'm a house church pastor. You know, we don't have the church building. We don't have a lot of the things that church buildings have. I challenge that stuff. I'm not so close-minded that I can't have anything challenged, any of my beliefs challenged. I'll, you know, talk things over with people. No problem. None at all. But see, that's not what this is about. That's not what these people are trying to truly do. They're trying to destroy the traditional church. That's what they're doing. They're not interested in saying, let's find you guys, you know, we'll respect you, we'll leave you alone, we won't cut on you. Uh-uh. There's a war against the traditional church. I'll defend church buildings. Okay? I'm not for them. I'm radically against 501c3. But if I know a man is doing a good work and he's getting the work of the Lord done, I will defend the man. Okay? I have some of my most highly respected brethren out there, and they are in church buildings. They are doing things that I don't personally do and I don't agree with and aren't backed up by Scripture, but I'm not going to do anything to destroy their ministry. I'll defend them. Okay? I'll send people to them. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Next poster. Church history. Gloating stories of those who triumphed by cruelly suppressing minority viewpoints. Well, I would agree with that if you're talking about Catholics, because that's how it always has been with Catholics. They have been the majority, and they always persecute the minority, the Bible-believing Christians. And you say, oh, you mean Protestants? No, Protestants are rotten oftentimes, too. Many of the Protestant denominations, like the Lutherans especially, they're just as lost as a Catholic. I'm not a Protestant. I'm not a Catholic. I'm a Bible believer. All right, we go back. We predate both Catholics and Protestants. Do some research on that. The Waldensians, the Vaudois, the Paulicians, the Donatists, a lot of those people. We predate the Catholics and the Protestants. Okay, I'm an Anabaptist. My ancestors were Anabaptists. That's why they came here to America, for religious freedom, liberty of conscience. Okay, that's a concept that was brought out by Christians, not liberals or something like that. Liberty of conscience is a Christian concept. What's liberty of conscience? Conscience, excuse me. Liberty of conscience is you should be allowed to worship whatever you want, however you want, with freedom, as long as you're not a threat to other people, which Catholics and Muslims often are. But study history. But you talk about minority viewpoints. Bible-believing Christians have always been the minority, not these emergent, you know, wing nuts, wackos. Go on to the next one here. Authenticity. I'm tired of having to pretend I'm not crazy. In other words, just let it all hang out. Just if you're nuts, if you're crazy, if you're possessed with devils, just, you know, act like a weirdo. You know, don't try to suppress your flesh. Don't try to bring your flesh under subjection, as the Bible says you're supposed to do. Oh no, don't do that. Just do whatever feels good. It's nihilism, is what that's called. Continuing here, now we got a real spiritual looking guy. Contextualization. If you're such a prude you don't cuss, you got nothing to say to me. Look at a guy. A pagan. He's a heathen. Okay, you start messing your body up like that, there's something wrong. Okay, you're possessed. I mean, the guy's got pentagrams on his throat, tattooed pentagrams on his throat. Five-pointed stars are pentagrams, okay? Got these rings in his ears and stuff like that. I remember watching a documentary the one time about these Indians down in South America that, trying to think of the name of them. They killed the missionaries down there. I don't have this written down. I can't think of the Jim Elliot was the one that they killed. But these Indians, they showed them, you know, before they got saved, and they had the same things that this guy has. They had these wooden rings in their ears. People looked at that years ago and they said, man, look at them pagans, look, heathen people. And they were. And praise God, a lot of them got saved. That's wonderful. But this practice is coming into America now. Why? Well, a good saying, I know Dr. Ruckman always says it, back to the Bible or back to the jungle. If this isn't your standard, then what it is the flesh. And oftentimes, devils come into somebody like that guy, and you just start to attack your flesh and defile your flesh. We're going to see about that as we continue. And you say, well, I don't know about this thing, you know, I think tattoos are okay for Christians. Let's look at that. Leviticus chapter 19, verse 28. Ye shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor print any marks upon you. I am the Lord. Now you say, oh, that's Levitical law. That's in the Old Testament. Okay, could you please give me some scripture in the New Testament that undoes that law? You see, there are laws back in the Old Testament that talk about you're not to eat unclean animals. But in the New Testament, every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused if it be received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God in prayer. See, it's been redone. The Old Testament says, keep the Sabbath day. New Testament, Romans chapter 13, verse 9, Sabbath day is not mentioned among the commandments that we're supposed to keep as Christians today. Why? Because it's a sign to the Jews. That's what the Sabbath day is all about. And you see the disciples, the early Christians, were meeting on the first day of the week. That's Sunday. Okay? So there are things that are written in the Old Testament that in the New Testament, they're undone. We don't have to sacrifice animals anymore. We don't have to bring a turtle dove when you have a child or something like that. That's been done away with. But where in the Bible, where in your New Testament does it say anything at all about now it's okay to print marks on your body and to make cuttings in your flesh? You see, what you're doing when you're printing things all over your body, all over your flesh, when you're getting tattoos and you're getting piercings and you're putting metal things through and wood things through your ear and whatever else, what you're doing is you're showing contempt for the body that God gave you. That's exactly what you're doing. Now I'm going to show you some things here. Remember the thing about making cuttings in your flesh for the dead. Mark chapter 5, verse 1 through 7. Let's read this. And they came over unto the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains, because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. And always night and day he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. You see the tie-in there, back to Leviticus? Mark 5, verse 6. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him. Verse 7, and cried with a loud voice and said, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. Luke chapter 8, verse 27 says something interesting too about this same man. And when he went forth to land, there met him out of the city a certain man which had devils long time and wore no clothes, neither abode in any house but in the tombs. Okay? Now, according to the scriptures, there are six signs of somebody being possessed with a devil. And that's the proper term. Demon possession is not actually a Bible term. The word demon is actually basically a transliterated Greek word. The proper translation is devil. There's a lot more I could say about that. But there are six signs. If you want to see somebody who's possessed with a devil, they'll manifest some or all of these six signs. Number one, you saw there that he liked being around tombs and death. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 36 says, "But he that sinneth against me wrongeth his own soul. All they that hate me love death." Death is a terrible thing. And you know how you can tell that America is becoming possessed on almost a national scale? When you see people that like to play games that glorify death. And it's now entertainment to kill people. What you have is you have a nation that is coming under satanic possession as a nation. That's what you have. If you hate God, you'll love death. And you'll like to be around tombs. Number two, the second sign of devil possession, strange, unexplained physical strength. Said about there that he was bound with chains and he just break them. And he was a skinny guy. It wasn't some bodybuilder or something like that. But watch out for this thing of these guys being able to do amazing feats of strength and they don't have the physical mass to really explain it. Look out for that. Number three, you can't reason with them or tame them, as the Bible says. No man could tame him. There are people that it doesn't matter, you can't get through to them. You can't tame them. That's another mark of being possessed with devils. Number four, unnatural and excessive crying. It's one thing to cry, everybody's going to cry sometime, that's fine. But when you have unnatural and excessive crying, you might be looking at some possession there, some possession issues. Number five, they will worship Jesus, but their worship will always be twisted and unscriptural. You say, oh, now, come on now, oh boy, we just read it. Mark chapter 5, you can read the verses yourself. Mark 5, 1 through 7, and verse 6 says, he ran and worshiped him. And he said there, cried with a loud voice and said, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? Now, if you got a guy in a church, one of these modern churches, and he stood up and he said, I believe Jesus is the Son of the Most High God. You know what the average Christian would say? They'd say, well, praise the Lord. That's neat. I'm glad to hear that. But it's the confession of a man that's possessed with devils. Now, that should give you some thought there, some concerns. Don't believe, people say, all somebody has to do is just say they believe in Jesus. Well, the Bible says that the devils believe. Be real careful. Number six, manifestation of devils in somebody, public nakedness or desire to wear as few clothes as possible. That's another sign that America is becoming possessed as a nation. A desire just to, this unnatural, just, oh man, people just have to walk around with as little clothing on as they can. And people, that are in pornography, there's something wrong there, spiritually. These people that want to be nude publicly, public or nude beaches and stuff like that, devils. That's what the Bible says. Deal with it. And you say, what about swearing? This guy said if you don't cuss, if you're too much of a prude not to cuss, what about that? James chapter 3, verse 5 and 6 says, even so the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members that it defileth the whole body and setteth on fire the course of nature and is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beasts and of birds and of serpents and of the things and of things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of mankind. Look at this one, chapter 3, verse 8. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. Remember what the Bible said there about the man possessed with devils? No man could tame him. Where does it begin? Right there. And even as a Christian, even the most spirit-filled Christian still has struggles with their tongue, with their mouth. Continuing here, verse 9. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Doth a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh. If you're a Christian, there shouldn't be any profanity coming out of your mouth. Okay, you know, I've seen these people, I'm a Christian, and then you see them get mad and they just bleep, 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 and they'll cuss like a sailor. Make a sailor blush some of the things these people say. Oh, but they're Christians. Don't think so. Matthew chapter 15, verses 10 through 14. And he called the multitude and said unto them, hear and understand. This is Jesus speaking here. Verse 11. Not that which goeth into the mouth defileth a man, but that which cometh out of the mouth, this defileth a man. Then came his disciples and said unto him, knowest thou that the Pharisees were offended after they heard this saying? But he answered and said, every plant which my heavenly Father hath not planted shall be rooted up. Let them alone, they be blind leaders of the blind, and if the blind lead the blind, both shall fall into the ditch. You see, the Pharisees were offended because Jesus Christ said, the stuff that you eat, that doesn't defile you, spiritually speaking. The things that you say, that defiles you. And see, he was attacking the Pharisees when he did that. Just like these wicked devils right there, the guy said, you know, if you're too much of a prude to cuss, then you don't have anything to say to me. Well, see, what's he doing? He's a Pharisee that's offended by people that don't swear. He's a true Pharisee. Holds his own traditions and his own feelings above Scripture. But some people say, well, you know, well, didn't Jesus swear? I actually heard a guy say that the one time. Let's look about that. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 21 through 23 says, for even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously. There was no guile found in the mouth of Jesus Christ. He was perfect. He was without sin. And I heard Bill Cooper the one time, the conspiracy guy, he said, well, Jesus cussed when he cussed out the tree, the fig tree, you know, he cussed it out. So it's okay for me to swear.
You shouldn't curse. You shouldn't do things that upset other people, because that's what Jesus spent his whole life doing. What about the time he cursed the fig tree? And the pious Christians sometimes make me very angry. They don't even know Christianity. They don't know the man they're following. He was a revolutionary. He was a dangerous man. And by God, so am I.
No. No, I don't think so. Let's look at actually what Jesus said. Jesus' words are actually recorded in the Bible. And you do well when somebody says, well, Jesus did this or do that. You say, chapter and verse. Give me some scripture. What Jesus said to that fig tree is recorded in Matthew chapter 21, verse 19. Let's read it. It says here, and when he saw a fig tree in the way, he came to it and found nothing thereon but leaves only, and said unto it, let no fruit grow on thee henceforward forever. And presently the fig tree withered away. So his words that he spoke was, let no fruit grow on thee henceforward forever. Did you see any profanity in there? No. What he was cursing there, when he cursed the fig tree, it wasn't profanity. He was saying, die, and it died. That's all that was going on there. Don't try to pervert the scriptures and make Jesus out to be a sinner because you're a sinner and you want company. Okay, Jesus never used profanity. Now this next poster here, the emergent poster, is rather disgusting, but that's what these people do. Here you have body modification. Yeah, so what? It's no big deal. You can make yourself out to look like a monster, a hideous freak. That's what these people do. They just destroy themselves. Why? 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16 and 17 says, "Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are." This right here is the temple of God. This doesn't belong to me. When I got saved, I traded ownership. You say, oh, you owned your body before you were saved? No, the devil owned it. I was a child of wrath, a child of disobedience, one of Satan's kids. I was going to spend eternity in hell with him. He was my father at that point in time. And I came to the Lord and I said, I'm a sinner. I can't save myself. Please save me. I believe in the death, burial, and resurrection, the blood that Jesus Christ shed on the cross. And that blood is the purchase price for my redemption. And when that transaction happened, that purchase price bought me. And now this body that I have is not mine. That's why I'm here, sitting in front of this camera. If this body was mine, there's a million things I'd rather be doing than ministry. Spending a couple days putting together this thing and getting people attacking me and everything else. There's a lot of other things I could be doing. But you see, this body isn't mine. This life isn't mine. It belongs to the Lord because I'm His purchased possession. That's why I'm here. That's why I'm speaking to you. Continuing on here, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 and 20. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? For ye are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Ephesians 5:25 through 27 says, Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify it and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Your body is to be pure. Why? Because it's not your body. If somebody lets you rent a home, you know what that your landlord wants? He wants his home to be kept in good condition. That house isn't yours. It's just being borrowed by you. Your body is not yours as a Christian. It's just on loan from the Lord. And if you mess around and you defile this flesh, God will take you home if you're a Christian, if you're truly saved. Now, if you're a Christian and you have a tattoo, you made a mistake, you got one, you know, you were away from the Lord or whatever else, and you've gotten a tattoo, keep it covered. All right? It's a sin. Well, you know, I don't know if it's a sin. I think it's up to the individual. It's a sin. It always has been a sin, and it always will be a sin. And if you're dumb enough to get a tattoo, and I know Christians that are, I know Christians that have, you know, and it's a stupid decision. It's a stupid thing to do, but if you get one, keep it covered. It's a bad testimony. And you're going to have to answer to the Lord for doing it someday. I'm not gonna sugarcoat things for you. I'm not gonna tell you that your sin is okay in God's sight because He loves you and you're, you know, when you disobey your Heavenly Father and you go against His book, you're gonna pay for it. It's the way it is. Next poster. Tolerance. Grace for those who are different. Okay. Tolerance does not appear in the King James Bible, and what the word, the modern word tolerance means. You know, it's not liberty of conscience saying, hey, you want to worship that way and you're not hurting anybody, go ahead. That's not modern tolerance. I'm okay with that kind of tolerance. All right, somebody doesn't want to accept Jesus Christ, they don't want to hear the gospel, I say, well, you're going to answer someday. See ya. I'm not going to go over and you know, take a gun and point it in their face and say, accept Jesus or I'll kill you. No. I live among lost people. You know, there are lost people here in the area where I live. I'm not going to forcibly convert them. You know, I'll tolerate them if they tolerate me. You know, and even if they don't tolerate me, I'll still tolerate them. Whatever. But that's not what tolerance is meaning here in this poster. Okay? What they're trying to say is that you should have grace for people that are living in sin and you shouldn't judge them. You know, that's the big thing, the motto among the modern church. Don't judge me. Who are you to judge me? Well, you better judge, because we have a perfect standard. But let's look at the picture there one more time. Read you some scriptures here. Proverbs 11:22. As a jewel of gold in a swine's snout, so is a fair woman which is without discretion. That girl could be very pretty if she wasn't a pig. You say, well, that's a terrible thing to say. She's mutilating herself, turning herself into some kind of a freak. And the Bible compares her to a pig wallowing around in the mud with a ring in its nose. That's what a lot of these people are with all the weird piercings. Again, deal with it. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 22. Here's what the Lord thinks of you women out there that are in sin. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb. The dog, there's your man, is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. So the Lord looks down at people who have heard the gospel and rejected the gospel, and he says, that guy down there, he's a dog eating his own vomit. And that Christ-rejecting woman down there, she's a pig wallowing it around in the mud. See, the Lord uses country, you know, symbology and analogy. Let's go on to the next one. Community. Journeying together with a common missional purpose. They like to that little word missional there. You'll see that a lot too, you know, the whole Catholic thing. But, you know, watch out for this thing of community. I talked about that in a sermon. Community is not in your King James Bible. Okay? The word there is congregation. Big difference between a congregation and a community. Continuing. Fruitcake bazaar here. Missional. The new chief end of man. Glorify whatever's lowbrow and enjoy it forever. You're to glorify sin. Gamble. Go out there and, you know, cards and everything else. I mean, study the thing about playing cards. What they really are symbolic of. You know, a lot of the tarot card type of a thing, you know. There. Can't get into that right now, but the point is, you glorify whatever's lowbrow and enjoy it forever. Well, you will enjoy it forever, at least down here on this earth, and then you'll go to hell forever if you get into that stuff. It says here, culture, it's not what your parents thought it was. It's every cheesy and lowbrow fad they would have called worldly. Engage it. Romans 12:2 says, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. A real Christian is a nonconformist. A real Christian looks at lowbrow fads and things that are worldly and says, I don't want anything to do with it. That's what a real Christian is. Now here, the next poster has this bozo on there. Cultural awareness. Following Bono to the pub, to the concert, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. Again, another blasphemous attack on the Lord Jesus, replacing Jesus Christ with this loser, this New World Order stooge. Bono from U2. And they're going to follow him, by the way. You say, oh, I want to follow Bono. Okay, you're going to follow him to hell. If that's what you want. Next poster. Optimism. We don't deny that we are fallen. We just prefer not to mention it. In other words, don't judge sin. Yeah. Continuing on here. Comfy chairs, because preaching is an act of violence toward the wills of the people who have to sit there and take it. Well, you know, if you're from the emergent movement, you probably haven't made it this far. Probably the only people that have watched this far or listened to this far are Bible-believing Christians, because they can't handle it. You know, these emergent people, I'm saying, can't handle it. They can't handle truth. But, you know, it's an act of violence. Maybe we should call it terrorism. Maybe we ought to make internment camps for preachers of the gospel. Yeah, you've done it to us before. You know, I'm sure that they're going to do it again. And you're going to have these emergent, wicked, modern people leading the charge to go out and kill Christians, real ones. Post-evangelical, because cursing the darkness is easier than turning on a light and a lot more fun. Sure, being in darkness is fun, apparently, if you are going to hell. Child of wrath, child of darkness. I'm a child of light. Sorry, I like light. I like bright. I don't like darkness. Labels. On to the next one. You have a bottle of poison there. Labels. Hate them. They take all the mystery out of the packaging. Again, so intelligent. What an intelligent, you know, line of reasoning here. You know, oh, it's a lot more fun just to drink a bottle and realize it's poison and die, you know. It's more fun to go out and live in sin and then realize when you die that you're actually going to hell because you didn't live for Jesus Christ. You didn't accept Jesus Christ. Oh, that's fun. Yeah. Let's look at the next one. Liberty. What do you mean, worldly? You're not the boss of me anyway. Now, look closely at this picture. The guy's, you know, the ball and chain there with the earth and whatever else. I can't read all of it, but it says, apply directly to the forehead. The word's right there. You mean like the mark of the beast? Yeah, that's exactly it. These people are satanic. Revelation 20 verse 4 says, and I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Revelation 14 verses 9 through 11 says, and the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels, and in the presence of the Lamb, and the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast in his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Don't let anybody tell you that hell is just an annihilation. You go there and you burn and then you're gone. Forever and ever, the smoke of their torment ascendeth up. That's the way it is. Hell's eternal. You don't have to go there. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. But that's where the people go who take the mark in the coming time of Jacob's trouble, which is just around the corner. It's getting closer every second. I mean, it's amazing to me to see how things are accelerating to that time period. And I think that there's the technology is definitely there. It's available for this mark of the beast. And I think you're going to see that thing coming soon. I'm not going to be here. The Bible teaches a pre-tribulation rapture. More on that in the future. On to the next one here. And by the way, let me just say one other thing. If you take the mark, it's what it says there in Revelation 14, 9 through 11. If any man takes the mark, he goes to hell. No chance to get saved. So don't ever fall for somebody saying, well, you can take the mark and still be saved. No, you can't. On to the next poster. Post-foundationalism. Descartes built on a shaky foundation, and see what happened? You think you know where there's solid rock? How arrogant. Besides, we already feel right at home here in the uncertainty of the postmodern mudslide. So knowing the solid rock apparently is arrogant. Why would you put this down in writing if you're a Christian? 1 Corinthians 3:11 says, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter 16, verse 17 said, "And Jesus answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say unto thee, Thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Jesus Christ is the rock of my salvation. He's the sure foundation that I build my faith upon. Peter is not the rock that Jesus built the church upon. You read a couple verses later, Jesus calls Peter Satan. "Get thee behind me, Satan, for thou art an offense unto me." That's kind of a rough rock to build a church on if Peter was the rock. But he isn't the rock. Okay? Just don't fall for that Catholic teaching. Another one here. Humility. "I'm not so arrogant as to think I've arrived at the truth about anything, but I'm pretty sure everything you say is not only dead wrong, but really, really stupid too." Well, I feel the same way about the emergent movement. It's the way it is. Although I do believe I've arrived at the truth. After going out and searching for truth and things and trying to find it other places, I now know where the source of all truth is. "Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth." It's right here. I'm holding the source of truth in my hands. And I impart this to as many people as I can and show them proper interpretation of Scripture so that they can in turn go out and give it to other people. I don't hold on to the truth and hide it and say, "You have to come and, you know, go through initiations to get it." No, here it is. You want it preached? Hey, what's your question? Let me answer it from Scripture. See, that's true Christianity. True Christianity is not made up of levels of initiation. That's occultism. And you look at any false cult out there, they will have those levels that you have to go up higher and higher and higher and higher. You know, and the people at the very highest levels, you know, they kind of have secrets that they keep from the people, the initiates, you know, down there. That's not what the Bible teaches for a Christian. You want to know anything? I have sermons out there, a lot of information out there. I answer people's questions all the time. Brand new Christian, hey, come along, you know. What about this? What about that? Let me show you from Scripture. Let me give you a book on that subject. That's the mark of a real Christian. You get into this kind of nonsense, you know, what? There's no truth out there. You can't arrive at the truth. Nonsense. Absolute nonsense. But John 16, verse 2 and 3 says, and this is where I think this emergent church movement is going. "They shall put you out of the synagogues. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God service. And these things they will do unto you because they have not known the Father nor me." Okay, speaking specifically to Jews in the coming time of Jacob's trouble, but we're heading into that system right now. And these people that profess that they know God, but in works they deny Him, you're going to see those people hunting down believers in the future and causing them to be put to death. And they're going to think that they're doing it for God. That's how these people are sick like that. Now, what was one of the big targets of Hitler? What was one of the groups that he went after? He went after the elderly. Look at the next poster here. "Empathy, a virtue too good to waste on elderly church members." Now let me tell you something. If you believe that way, if you don't have any respect for the older members of your church, you're not saved. Well, you know, they could be carnal. No. I'm sorry, but I don't have as much grace as some of the brethren do. Some of the brethren, I think, are compromising, you know, so they don't take such a hard line when it comes to salvation. I believe a true born-again Christian that has the Holy Spirit within them, God's Spirit's going to lead them to the truth, and there's going to be certain signs that they are saved. You see that in the Bible. And you get these people that are just totally foreign to Scripture. Their beliefs are so weird and so strange, and just like there's just not that connection there. There's no fellowship of the Spirit. I'm sorry, they're not saved. That's just the way it is. And people that disrespect the elderly in church are lost. What does the Bible teach about the elderly? Leviticus chapter 19, verse 32 says, "Thou shalt rise up before the hoary head," hoary meaning gray, "before the hoary head and honor the face of the old man and fear thy God, I am the Lord." Proverbs chapter 20, verse 29 says, "The glory of young men is their strength, and the beauty of old men is the gray head." Proverbs chapter 16, verse 31 says, "The hoary head is a crown of glory if it be found in the way of righteousness." Why is it a crown of glory? Because the Lord's blessed you with long life. Okay? It's a crown of glory. It's an honorable thing to have gray hair. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verses 1 and 2 says, "Rebuke not an elder, but entreat him as a father, and the younger men as brethren, the elder women as mothers, the younger as sisters, with all purity." You should respect older people. I'm going to be doing a message probably this coming Sunday on the subject of elderly Christians and how you need to respect them. Commandment number 5, the Ten Commandments. Commandment number 5, Exodus chapter 20, verse 12 says, "Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee." Did you know the secret to long life is honoring your parents? Honoring your mom and dad, your mother and father? Ephesians chapter 6, verse 2 says, "Honor thy father and mother," which is the first commandment with promise. Well, now we read what the promise was. And it's repeated here, verse 3, "that it may be well with thee and that thou mayest live long on the earth." You want long life? Honor your parents. Doesn't mean that you have to agree with everything that they do or have done, but you have to honor them. Even if you're saved and your mom and dad are lost, you should still honor them. You should witness to them, and they're probably going to get offended, but be honorable towards them. And when you see an older sister, an older brother in the church, you honor them. You can learn a lot from the elderly. They've been through things that are yet facing you in the future, and their experience that they've gained for many years can be a great benefit to you. I've benefited tremendously from listening to elderly people. If you're wise, you'll do the same. Now, the final poster here I want to look at is, it says, "Emerging, the church that is becoming." And I agree with this one. There is an emerging church. It's called the Antichrist Church. Someday, the whole world's going to worship the Antichrist and the dragon, which gives his power to the Antichrist. Who's the dragon? Satan. So I'm not fooling around when I say that this church is satanic, that this emergent church thing. They are satanic, and they are someday going to worship Satan in the form of the Antichrist. So, why did Satan raise up the wicked emergent church? Well, because the modern emerging churches are continually pushing, or I'm sorry, not the emerging churches, but the modern mainstream churches are continually pushing the envelope of what is acceptable as church practices. Okay? And their new philosophy is basically, if other churches are doing it and their numbers are growing, you know, people are coming in and you're getting more money, you know, that's the sign of success apparently as a Christian now. But if that's happening and there are other churches doing it, then we can do it too. That's what they believe. And you see, it's all because they don't believe the Bible anymore. The average modern church, this is no longer the standard. You know, if you would go in and start saying, "Hey man, the Bible doesn't say that. The Bible says this, the Bible says that. Right here's a verse, let me read it to you." They'd say, "You're a Bible thumper. You're a fundamentalist." Isn't that what I'm supposed to be? Didn't Jesus say, "If a man love me, he'll keep my words"? You see how bad things have gotten? There are three core philosophies of the emergent church, and these are entering in to the vast majority of modern churches. And you know, most modern churches, they'll look at these same pictures and they'll say, "Oh, you know, we reject that." Yeah, but the philosophy's there. Here are the three philosophies. Number one, you have no final authority in the Bible. All this book is good for is some nice verses occasionally to motivate people. This is a motivational tool. That's all this book is good for anymore to the average Christian, professing Christian. Number two is total nihilism. Nihilism is you do what feels good. You can be as gods, knowing good and evil. If it feels good, do it. That's what nihilism is, and that's what the average modern Christian is. The average modern Christian has no restraint at all on their flesh. If they want a tattoo, they'll get a tattoo. If they want piercings, they'll get piercings. If they want to drink and get drunk, they'll get drunk. If they want to watch an R-rated movie, they'll watch an R-rated movie. Whatever the average modern Christian wants to do, they'll do it. And they will get mad at you if you're a Bible-believing Christian and you point out their sin and say, you're wrong. They'll get mad at you. They'll listen to whatever kind of music they want to listen to. They'll dress however they want to dress. You can go on and on. They don't want standards. They don't want thus saith the Lord. They want their feelings to be the final authority. And the third philosophy of the emergent church is that the only group that you attack, you accept everybody, you love everybody, you tolerate everybody, and the only group that you attack are Bible-believing Christians, like me. They're the only people that these modern emergent types will attack. The only ones. I've studied them. I've studied them for years. I've studied the whole movement of the modern church movement. They will only attack Bible-believing Christians. But what does the Bible say? I'm going to hit a couple more scriptures here and then we're done. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Read through 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 sometime and you'll see what brings in the Antichrist. And what is it? Falling away. And we're in it right now. And I think we're getting towards the end of the falling away. You say, well, I think it could get a lot worse. It could get a lot worse, but a loving and just God isn't going to let it get much worse. He's about ready to judge. And you're already seeing judgment hitting America. But see, there's a problem. You see, because God, you read through the whole entire Bible, and when God's wrath is poured out, he always spares the just. There's never been a time when God has said, I'm going to pour out my wrath on the just and on the wicked. He doesn't do it. He spares his children, and he's going to do that in the future. And God's not going to put up with much more of this, with much more of this vile filth that I've showed you, that these emergent church people put out. God's not going to put up with much more of it. All right? And the emergent church is bringing in the Antichrist, and they're going to worship him when he shows up. 1 John chapter 2, verse 18. Little children, it is the last time, and as ye have heard that Antichrist shall come, even now are there many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time. Let me just stop there for just 1 minute. Antichrist means against Christ, but it also means false Christ. And there are many false Christs out there. There are many people that are against Jesus Christ. There are many Antichrists, but the big guy, the man of sin, the son of perdition, he's going to show up yet in the future. But he can't show up until the real body of Christ is gone. Okay? Read Revelation chapter 5. Great multitude shows up, which no man could number, that are redeemed by the blood of the Lamb out of every kindred, people, tongue, nation. And then in Revelation 6, the first seal is open and the Antichrist is unleashed. So the body of Christ is in heaven before the Antichrist shows up. It has to be that way. There can't be two Christs here on the earth at the same time. I've done a lot of studies on that if you want to hear more. 1 John chapter 2, verse 19. They went out from us, but they were not of us. These emergent people, they say, oh, we were raised in the old traditional church, but we're different now. They went out from us. They act like they're Christians. They say that they're Christians, but they were not of us. How do you know? For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. You know what the modern church movement is? It's proof of the people who aren't really saved. The people There are people that are probably raised in them things that don't know any better, but you see these ones that I was raised in that traditional church and I hate it now. I don't want anything to do with the King James Bible. I don't want anything to do with saying Jesus is the only way. I deny the fundamentals of the faith. You know what they are? They're antichrists. They went out from us, but they're not of us. For had they been of us, they would have continued with us. Those Christians that you see dogmatically standing by the King James Bible, standing by dressing appropriately and listening to the right kind of music, standing for the old faith, those Christians are the ones that are truly saved. What should Bible-believing Christians do? Okay, what should you do if you're a Bible believer? Jude 1 verse 3 and 4 says, "Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that ye should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints." That's what I'm doing right now. I'm earnestly contending for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. Okay? That's what I'm supposed to do. That's what you're supposed to do as a Christian. Verse 4. "For there are certain men crept in unawares, which were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ." That's exactly what this emergent church has done. They deny God, they deny Jesus Christ, and they turn the grace of our God into lasciviousness. Lasciviousness means basically an overindulgence of animal desires. And that's what these people are. They're actually many times lower than an animal as far as what they do, how they conduct themselves in life. You're not going to see an animal, you know, mutilating itself and printing marks all over itself and acting all weird and everything. You're not going to see an animal do that. An animal has more sense than that. These people are less intelligent than an animal. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 through 18. Final piece of advice here, and then we'll close. "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand." Stand, in other words, don't back down, don't compromise. Verse 14, "Stand, therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints." In conclusion, I just want to say this. This has been kind of a rough study for me to put together because it's just been very vexing. You know, the things that are passing off as church now are just so vile and blasphemous. It's really just so disheartening. And I know I've spoken to a lot of Christians from all over the world, and I get the same story many times, and that is, what on earth am I supposed to do? There aren't any churches left in the area. Yeah, I know. I can relate to that. What you're supposed to do is you're supposed to stand. Not back down. I know most Christians aren't going to fall for any of this emergent stuff. They're not going to get messed up in that movement. If you're truly saved, you know, you aren't going to fall for that. But I'm telling you right now, this is leading the charge, so to speak, for the modern churches. What's going on there with the emergent movement is making its way into the modern churches. If you are in a modern church, you need to get out of that thing. Okay? If they're not using the King James Bible, if they're putting contemporary music in, and there's no dress standards, and you're seeing a lot of things that just don't appear in the Bible, you need to get out. Run from it. Okay? It's just going to keep getting worse. The Bible says there's a falling away. If I took something here, and I don't have anything I can do it with, but if I took something and knocked it off the side of my desk, is there some point in time when the falling away, all of a sudden it's going and it just and stops before it hits the ground and reverses course and starts to come back up? No, that would defy the laws of science. The second law of thermodynamics, if you want to be specific, the law of entropy. Okay? Everything tends towards chaos, towards disorder. Every dispensation in the Bible, every single one of them, ends in apostasy and destruction. Every single time, no exceptions. And a lot of preachers out there are trying to preach revival, we can bring about a revival. No, you can't. This country is too far gone. All that we have to look forward to at this point as Christians is the catching away of the body of Christ. The bride of Christ is going to be leaving. And Christ is coming for a spotless bride, by the way. You say, well, then if I have a tattoo, I'm not spotless and I won't go up. No. I don't believe that way. I don't, you know, teach that. Okay, there's a lot of Christians out there that are going to have some spots on them that are going to need to be, you know, judged of the Lord. I understand that. Okay, there are carnal Christians. I understand all that stuff. But as a Christian, your desire, your goal should be to live in a way that pleases the Lord. That's the purpose of why we were created. We were created for God's pleasure. He has no greater joy than to hear that His children walk in the truth. Okay? That's why you're here. We are to be holy as our Heavenly Father is holy. And that's why you must reject any of this kind of movement over here. Now, if you're an emergent person and you've made it this far, and I've been calling you a lot of names and everything else, I'm calling the system names. And if you're into the system and you believe firmly in the system and you're just making fun of me and whatever, then yeah, those names apply to you. But if you have been deceived by this movement and you've fallen for this thing and you're going, you know, man, this guy showed a lot of scripture and I don't fit in to what a true Christian is about, and you want to change, you want to repent, change direction, then I would suggest you watch my salvation message. Okay? And I say my because I put it together. All right? It's salvation based on the pages of the King James Bible, based on Scripture. Okay? Not my feelings, not my opinions about it. Based on Scripture. So that's going to be it for this study. Very long, very detailed. But if you made it the whole way through, thank you very much for watching. And I pray that you'll warn other people about this horrible system, this emergent movement. And, you know, watch some of the stuff where they're actually promoting Catholicism. They're actually trying to get people back under the Catholic Church. I mean, it's a bad, bad system. So stay in God's book. I've quoted it twice, I think, already. I'll do it a third time. John 17:17, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. This is the only chance that you have. Get in the book, stay in the book, memorize the book. Make this thing a part of your mind. Conform to this book, not to the world. So that's it. Thank you very much for watching.